The groundbreaking ceremony will take place tomorrow in Selma for Fresno County's Rural Transit Maintenance Facility. I'm Alexis Molina with the preview coming up next.
Also tonight, this just in from Visalia PD, a Mount Whitney campus supervisor is arrested for an alleged inappropriate relationship with a 15-year-old student. And later...
We make our own success here. And our success is defined by the children and families we serve and their health and well-being.
Valley Children's Hospital is on a Green Thumb mission tonight. We'll explain.
New, local, unique. My TV 53 News at 8 starts right now.
Hi, everybody. Welcome to the San Joaquin Valley's only 8 p.m. news. I'm Austin Reed. Thank you for joining us. It is Thursday, April the 20th. Our big story is in Fresno County, where a new rural transit hub has its groundbreaking ceremony tomorrow morning. We're previewing it for you tonight. Earlier today, we spoke with Selma Mayor Scott Robertson about this. Reporter Alexis Molina joins us with all of the details. Hi, Alexis.
Construction is moving forward on the new Fresno County Rural Transit Maintenance Facility. MyTV 53, along with our partners at Stool News, caught up with Selma Mayor Scott Robertson today.
It's important not just to Fresno County, it's also important to Selma in that Fresno County is getting its first permanent owned facility by the FCRTA after 42 years in operation.
The project will be equipped with 10 Level 3 electric vehicle chargers to serve electric transit buses, 10 Level 2 EV chargers to serve electric transit vans, and a public access compressed natural gas station capable of serving both transit buses and over-the-road Class 8 trucks. The project will also include approximately 1.3 to 2.0 megawatts of on-site solar power and 500 kilowatt hour of battery storage to support electric vehicle charging.
So the value of the building is going to be $15 million, which makes it probably the most valuable building and construction project we've had in Selma. It's a really big deal for our city. And it's a big deal because it's also going to bring jobs.
The FCRTA operates 25 transit subsystems with 120 vehicles that operate in 13 rural incorporated cities throughout Fresno County. In addition, the FCRTA has 13 maintenance yards in rural areas. The proposed project would have approximately 10 to 20 employees daily. The amount of buses each day would be minimal based on the maintenance schedule and rotation. Buses would be stored off-site and would travel to the site for scheduled services and California Highway Patrol inspections. Buses would be driven in by shuttle drivers or would be towed in if broken down.
One of the chargers coming in is a linear induction charger, which will charge the big buses a lot faster than the other chargers, which is more efficient and it will help the operations and help get those buses out.
FCRTA will be utilizing Federal Transit Administration funding in the amount of $5.1 million for a portion of this project. The project is projected to be completed by January 2024. The groundbreaking ceremony will take place tomorrow at 10 a.m. in Selma. From MyTV 53 News at 8, I'm Alexis Molina. Austin, back to you.
Exciting stuff, Alexis. Thank you for that. Earlier this afternoon in Selma, an information session for the State Route 99 Selma to Fowler project was held for the public to discuss this project, answer any questions, and address any concerns. The meeting was held inside the Selma City Hall. Now, earlier this week, we spoke with the owner of the Selma Auto Mall, who is not happy about this project.
Caltrans has had significant problems on the Highway 99 work from Selma up to, I guess it would be Clovis Avenue, over the past, it's been like almost a year's delay, I guess, but they've had one problem after another. They're telling us when they shut these off-ramps down, it will only be for 2 months, but I have been told also by people that are in the industry, expect 6 to 8 months of shutdown.
Meanwhile, the next stage of construction on this project starts tonight, with new ramp closures projected to go into effect and last about 2 weeks. Caltrans detour signs are in place utilizing Whitson Avenue. The city says they will place alternate detour signs utilizing Nebraska and Highland Avenues. And new tonight, the County of Fresno is now applying for a Clean California grant to beautify and improve Golden State Boulevard from American to Mission Street in Kingsburg. Beautification will include upgraded lighting and trash receptacles, community art installations, landscaping, tree plantings, and more. Today, the City of Kingsburg announced a brand new survey they want residents to fill out. Just head to the City of Kingsburg's Facebook page to find out how you can let your voice be heard. Meanwhile, in Madera County today, a groundbreaking ceremony was held earlier this morning for the 99 Cottonwood Bridge Project. The $36.8 million project is to replace three aging bridges on State Route 99 over Cottonwood Creek in Madera County. According to a 2011 test on the bridge, water and salt had reached levels that corroded the steel in the reinforced concrete of this bridge. We have one more traffic alert for you tonight. Caltrans spent the day knocking down and removing loose rocks off State Route 140 between Mid Pines and Briceburg in Mariposa County for the safety of the traveling public. Work is supposed to continue from 7 a.m. to 7 p.m. daily with a one-way traffic control in place. For updates on this project, check in with the Caltrans District 10 Facebook page. New tonight and developing from the Fresno County Sheriff's Office, just before midnight last night, sheriff's deputies were dispatched to a home on the 8100 block of South Hughes Avenue for an assault with a deadly weapon. This is located between Easton and Raisin City. Deputies arrived and found multiple people suffering from stab wounds. One died at the scene. Three others were transported to the hospital. Deputies did detain one suspect. Officials do say this was an isolated incident, as all of the people involved are known to each other. The investigation will continue. This just in from Visalia Police. In the early evening hours on Wednesday, Visalia officers were called to Mount Whitney High School for a report of a school employee having an alleged inappropriate relationship with a student. Officers found that the 15-year-old girl had been exchanging nude photos and videos with 37-year-old Dejon Jones, the suspect, who is the Mount Whitney campus supervisor. Officers also learned Jones had touched the girl inappropriately. They worked closely with VUSD to ensure the safety of other students by the apprehension of Jones, who was taken into custody during a traffic stop earlier this morning. The man was transported and booked into the Tulare County Adult Pretrial Facility. Jones has been immediately placed on administrative leave by the Visalia School District. This just in from the Merced County Sheriff's Office. Yesterday afternoon at around 2:30, deputies responded to the West America Bank located in Hillmar for a report of a robbery. An unidentified adult male entered the bank and approached a bank teller demanding money. After receiving the cash, the suspect fled the scene before the deputies arrived. The suspect tonight described as an adult male last seen wearing a face mask, black beanie, gray t-shirt, and khaki-colored pants. Detectives are still investigating this incident. They want to find this guy. If you have any information regarding the robbery, do contact the Merced County Sheriff's Office. And finally, in your first few minutes of nonstop news here at 8 o'clock, this story is trending all across the country. SpaceX's giant week meets a fiery end today, but company officials still say the launch of Starship was a success. Voice of America's Arash Arbasadi explains.
Giant news this week from private spaceflight company SpaceX. The company saw initial success in testing its massive 120-meter Starship spacecraft from a launch pad in Boca Chica, Texas. But just a few minutes after launch, things went south as the world's most powerful rocket failed to separate, sending it on a wild ride.
We should have had separation by now. Obviously, this does not appear to be a nominal situation.
Yeah, it does appear to be spinning, but I do want to remind everyone that everything after clearing the tower was icing on the cake.
No one was on board. Company officials stressed this was just a test and had always said that simply getting the rocket off the pad would count as a win. SpaceX CEO Elon Musk congratulated the team in a tweet adding, "Learned a lot for the next launch." This launch had already been delayed. SpaceX called off Monday's scheduled test of Starship after a frozen valve caused issues with the booster. SpaceX says Starship will be able to carry as many as 100 people on a trip to Mars. But there's plenty of work yet to be done. Musk says Starship will be used for satellite launches around Earth before carrying humans anywhere. He predicts at least one of his growing fleet of Starships will reach orbit by year's end. SpaceX launched Transporter 7 to low Earth orbit from Vandenberg Space Force Base in California. The company says it was the seventh mission dedicated to SmallSat Rideshare, which is another way of saying it carried a host of small satellites into orbit along with other payloads. One of SpaceX's Dragon capsules undocked from the International Space Station this week, carrying nearly 2,000 kilograms of scientific experiments and cargo back to Earth. It was the company's 27th resupply mission for NASA. Arash Arabasadi, VOA News.
That does it for your first few minutes of nonstop news here at 8 o'clock. We are just getting started, though. Coming up, Valley Children's Hospital announcing earlier today an environmental strategy to build energy resiliency for hospital campus operations. Also ahead, we'll take a look at what's happening in Kern County for our viewers on KNXT. And we will have your full weather forecast as the weekend is getting closer. We've been talking about this the last few days. Get ready for a warm-up. You're watching MyTV 53 News at 8, new, local, unique. We are back in a little over 2 minutes.
This is MyTV 53 News. New, local, unique, with Austin Reed. You're watching MyTV 53 News at 8.
Welcome back, everybody, on this 20th of April. Now to our big stories in the Bakersfield area for our viewers on KNXT. Late yesterday, Kern County Sheriff's Office deputies from the East Area Substation went to the 1800 block of 130th Street West in Rosamond to a home of 44-year-old Sean Delatova. Well, Delatova had two active felony warrants for his arrest for stolen vehicles. Upon arrival yesterday, deputies located several stolen vehicles on the property, five stolen vehicles, a stolen motorcycle, and a stolen tractor. All seven of the stolen vehicles were removed from the property. Delatova was arrested and booked into the Mojave Jail for his active felony warrants, operating a chop shop, possession of stolen vehicles, tampering with cars, possession of a controlled substance, and felon in possession of ammunition. On a lighter note, but staying in Kern County, the Lake Ming Bike Project has recently been completed. We first told you about this late last week, but tonight, reporter Anna Marie Odo has some updated information about the project.
Kern County Public Works, in partnership with Kern Wheelman and Bike Bakersfield, has finished an exciting project just in time for spring with the extension of the bike path around Lake Ming. Earlier this month, Public Works held a grand opening ribbon cutting and inaugural bike ride to celebrate the completion of the project. This newly constructed paved path spans an additional 1.1 miles, making a continuous loop around the lake.
Today we're celebrating the grand ribbon cutting of the Kern County bike path, lake to lake, from Buena Vista Lake in the west to Lake Ming here in the east. It's a 3-month project, and courtesy of the Kern Council of Governments, Kern County Public Works, and in partnership with local groups like cyclists, like Bike Bakersfield, Kern Wheelman.
In Public Works, we just finished constructing the Lake Ming bike path extension. It's approximately 1 mile long. It does a full loop around the lake. So that way, if you're riding on the bike path, you don't have to get off the path. You just continuously make one big loop all the way around the lake and get to view the beautiful views right now of the lake. And at the ribbon cutting today, we had people of all ages. We had elderly people and children riding the bike path. So we know it's going to be a great benefit to the community.
Residents can hop on the Kern County bike path at Lake Ming and take it all the way to the Buena Vista Recreational Area for a total of 30 miles. To view an entire map of the trail, please visit kernpublicworks.com/walk-kern.
Just in time for the warmer weather. That was Anna Mariotto reporting.
My TV 53 News continues with the Valley's local forecast.
Buffalo soldier, dreadlock rasta. It was a buffalo soldier in the heart of America, stolen from Africa, brought to America, fighting an arrival, fighting for survival.
Connect with Austin on Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter. Follow, like, share at Austin Reed On Air.
And thank you for staying with us. Valley Children's Healthcare has launched a bold environmental strategy today to build energy resiliency for hospital campus operations and to drive efforts for improved air quality in the region. The plan will reduce greenhouse gas emissions by 50% by 2030 and will achieve net zero carbon emissions by 2050. It also includes the installation of the largest pediatric healthcare-based renewable energy microgrid in the country. New tonight, we are digging deeper.
As one of the top consumers of resources, products, devices, energy, water, we need to be better stewards. I think a lot of it is about how we change our thinking, how we change our culture. What we're doing as an organization and the environmental impact, we really need to be stepping into this space today. It's a long journey, and we need to start that work now.
This project really began as an attempt to improve the energy resilience of this site. There are some unique challenges here. In this community, it's a fast-growing community where the energy demands are rising rapidly. The local utility is struggling to keep up. This notion that we could do it with a renewable energy microgrid is a huge step forward.
So with the Inflation Reduction Act, we have an opportunity to receive credits and some support by taking these steps and making these investments today. And that might not be available to us in the future.
We have land right next to the hospital that we can access, where we'll put really a combination of fuel cells, batteries, and solar, so that when the wildfires come, when the rolling blackouts happen, Valley Children's will have a very safe electrical supply at a lower cost than what they have today. So it really is remarkable.
We make our own success here. And our success is defined by the children and families we serve and their health and well-being. It's really simple. So I think that the premise here is less about aging infrastructure and more about leading, because our board has a vision, relies upon itself, and relies upon our team to do the right thing for kids at every single turn. And the innovations that we invest in here are really in keeping with that self-reliance and to keep doing the work at the highest level so that kids benefit.
Since we know that the majority of health is actually determined or shaped by the community that one lives in, it's really imperative that we look outside of our four walls. We look outside of the walls of our offices and our hospitals. And we look at those things, those environments in which children live and grow and learn and play, and ensure that those are healthier places. Those are places for children where they can thrive and really reach their full potential.
This is not about Valley Children's looking great. This is about Valley Children's doing the right thing for future generations of kids.
Well, that is good news for our planet. Coming up next here on the News at 8, we've got a final story from the Fresno Unified School District. There's a big event happening this weekend. We'll tell you about it next. Hey, finally tonight, mark your calendars for Idea Fest 2023. It's going to take place this coming Saturday from 11 a.m. until 3 p.m. at Fresno City College.
Idea Fest is an opportunity for our Fresno Unified School District students from preschool through 12th grade to showcase their thinking, hard work, and brilliance to the Fresno community. This year, Idea Fest will be bigger and better, and we're asking for your participation to help it grow. The theme of this year's Idea Fest is Reflection, Recovery, Reimagining, exploring the stories of COVID-19 and the mental health connection.
And by the way, anybody is welcome to attend. Looks like a very cool event. All right, let's talk about your final weather forecast as we are getting closer to the weekend. As we have been saying the last few days, get ready for a warm-up. Those temperatures, our highs are just going to keep increasing. So it should be a fantastic kind of what? Second to last weekend here in April. Enjoy it. And that is going to do it for the news on this 420. However you spend it, stay safe. I'm Austin Reed, hoping your news is good news. I'll see you again tomorrow. Good night.